This was me when I was 9 years old. I absolutely loved studying and taking part in every single competition that I came across, taking part in student council, and of course, winning it. And then came grade 10, when studying was supposed to be a serious matter. So I gave NTSC, and not gonna lie, I did pretty well. I stood 8th in Telangana, and after that came the real deal, studying for NEET. Now, after having gone through it all, I know exactly where the shoe pinches. Physics.
एक जो बहुत कॉमन क्वेश्चन निकल के आता है मेडिकल एस्पिरेंट्स का वो है उन लोगों को फिजिक्स सबसे टफ लगता है पता नहीं क्यों बट सबसे टफ लगता है उन लोगों को फिजिक्स सबसे टफ लगता है पता नहीं क्यों बट सबसे टफ लगता है
और हम अभी नीट में
ऐसे टाइम पे था कि जब मेरे को फिजिक्स समझता नहीं था मैं सोचता था फिजिक्स बहुत ज्यादा हार्ड
था एंड आई टोटली अंडरस्टैंड
सो इन दिस वीडियो आई एम गोना टेल यू हाउ आई स्टडीड फिजिक्स फॉर नीट. You all must have watched some kind of a medical TV show, right? So from that you would know that for any operation, there's always a pre-op stage and a post-op stage, where op stands for operation. In the same exact way, I used to plan my studies for physics in three stages. Pre-class, that is before the class, one during the class, and post-class. Now my pre-class prep used to start with me first knowing what I'm going to study in the class a few days from now. And this preparation used to start at least a week before the particular chapter is going to be started in the class. This used to give me a fair idea of what I'm going to get myself into. Now you must be thinking what videos I used to watch. I used to just Google the particular chapter, or I used to type it up on YouTube, and whatever YouTube videos used to pop up, I used to just watch it. That used to do a good job in making me understand what is going to happen in the class. The second most important thing I used to do before even the class starts is to do questions. Now you must think, doing questions before class starts, how am I even supposed to know how to solve all that, right? But here's the catch. I used to solve not any question, but I used to solve the solved examples in my textbooks or reference materials. And all of these reference materials have solved examples in them. So I used to solve just that. However, I used to solve it in a different way. People usually read the question, read the solution, move on, read the question, read the solution, but no, that's not actually the right way to approach it, in my opinion. I used to always read the question, close the solution, open my notebook and start solving the question how much ever I can. So what this does is, before you even get into the class, you have a fair idea of how to solve and approach questions. So when a teacher would be giving you questions in the class, you would already know how to probably start approaching the question, which the others might not even know yet, right? Now, the third thing that I used to do is I used to read the whole of the NCRT before going to the class. I know NCRT's language might be difficult for some of you, but there's no harm in just trying to read it once, right? Even I would not understand the whole thing in my first read, right? It is not necessary that you understand it fully. Now, coming to class. In class, I used to just do two things, listen to the teacher and simultaneously just make my running notes. So I'm a very audiovisual learner, which means I retain things better when I see things happening. And the second way I learn things is by writing down. So combining these two, I used to always listen to what he's teaching and simultaneously write them down myself too in the form of running notes. Now comes the post-class stage, which is actually something that makes the most impact. After coming back home, I used to read the notes I made in the class the same night so that I have read the material three times over, once before the class, during the class, and at the end of the class at night before I went to sleep. That itself gives you a lot of clarity for the chapter very effortlessly. The next day, I used to read NCRT one more time and I used to read one of my reference books. So I had a ton of books. I had B.M. Sharma, D.C. Pandey, and H.C. Verma. And in my opinion, doing that helped me. Although people do say that you should read one book 10 times or 10 books one time, but I've personally found that certain books do a good job explaining certain chapters. So for example, I really like the mechanics from B.M. Sharma, and I really like the electromagnetism part from H.C. Verma. So I would rather read those chapters from those particular books because I found those books to be more helpful for that particular chapter, right? And then I also solve questions from my coaching module. Now, the main thing about physics is the last part, that is the solving questions part. No matter how much you read physics, how much you read theory, you will never ever be able to master physics unless you solve questions. It helps you encounter more cases, more models of questions, and slowly increases your grip in the chapter. After solving the questions comes the important part, getting your doubts cleared. I've seen so many people reading textbooks, making formula charts, solving questions, but almost half of those people used to not even ask their doubts. But asking doubts is a very important part of your learning process. If you don't ask doubts, then you will sort of reach a plateau. You will be able to solve the questions that is in your comfort zone. And you will never be able to break out of that comfort zone and solve questions that are difficult, that you need aid in, that you need help in. So it is important to approach your teacher no matter how strict they are. You need to go to them, bug them, and get your doubts cleared. That's exactly what I used to do. In breaks, after the class ends, before the class ends, I used to always go and bug my teachers. During the class, even in fact, whenever there used to be free time in the class, I used to ask the teachers my doubts. In fact, if you don't like going to the teacher and asking your doubts, there are many platforms online. There is Merit Nation, Doubt Nun. What else would I use? Yeah, just websites. And finally, after you're done doing all of this, the last part is probably the best time to make the formula charts. I've seen people reading textbooks and then making the formula charts immediately, but you don't know that which one of the two alternatives of a particular formula is more helpful. For example, for calculating effective EMF, there used to be a formula called E2R1 plus R1. What? There used to be a formula called E2R1 plus R2E1 by R1 plus R2. What the hell is this formula? Who learns this formula? Please don't learn all this. Instead, find the more useful modifications of such formulas. The one that I just told you all can only be used when you have two cells connected in parallel. What if they give you four cells in the question? Then what? You're gonna be stuck. That's why you need to search and write down formulae which is going to be universally applicable. So in this case, I would rather learn the formula effective EMF by effective resistance is equal to E1 by R1 plus E2 by R2 plus E3 by R3, so on. Just take the R effective, transpose it to the other side, and you get your effective EMF. I hope I've made myself clear. Now, before this video gets over, I would like to tell you all that this is how I studied physics. The same method may or may not be helpful for you to learn physics. Maybe you can take a few tips from what I said and tweak it to your own benefit. And another thing, I want to make it very clear that I'm not going to be one of those YouTubers who open their channel right after they get amazing marks in NEET. This is probably the only video I'm going to put right now unless you all request for more, because physics used to be my favorite subject and I think I studied physics pretty well, so I probably just wanted to put it out there.